Thank you very much indeed, and I greatly appreciate so many of you did show up on this very last event, especially after the big soccer victory. I want to congratulate the members of the team for this astonishing accomplishment. Today, in fact, I think the main novelty of the paper I am presenting here is the fourth dimension of legitimacy in Max Weber. I actually was unaware that Weber has four types of legitimation. I discovered it recently when I was studying the critical edition of Max Weber, and became very thrilled about this. I'm sure there is German language literature on this, but I have never seen any references to the four dimensions in English language. And for 40 years I was teaching Weber theory of legitimacy as the three types of legitimacy, and was intrigued to find that Weber had a force in his mind. And the other point in the paper will be that I would like to use Weber's theory of legitimacy to post-communist societies, just very briefly talking about the legitimacy problems in communist societies, and then to apply it in a comparative framework to various post-communist societies. And the fourth dimension is interesting from this point of view as well. So that's in a nutshell what the new in this is. I was unsure what is the level of familiarity with Weber's work. So I will do some very basic comments on Weber's theory of legitimacy, just to make sure that we have a common language. I know that you are coming from interdisciplinary fields. What I got to say in the first few minutes will be trivial for those who are sociologists or political scientists. May not be that trivial if somebody coming from economics, for instance, who are unlikely to study it. Weber's theory of domination is really the last and unfinished work. Economy and Society, and it's a very messy text. Weber himself was very aware how messy the text is, and he started to write it in 1911, and did not finish by September 1920, when he passed away. Though after 1919, he tried to bring some order into the book to make it more analytically clear. It disturbed him, the messiness of some of his concepts. So I will dare to use, in, let's put it, creative way, some of the concepts that Weber used. In the whole book, many of these concepts are used in different ways. But one point that I would like to emphasize before we go any further, that Weber use of concepts, first of all, the concepts are always ideal types. So he never believes that a concept has a precise equivalent in the empirical world. They are always abstractions from the empirical world, and they never exactly describe them. The second point is that Weber uses concepts typically as historical concepts, referring to specific historical instances, but they are also analytical concepts. So they can be used in different historical instances. And that's why I think many of Weber's concepts are actually applicable to contemporary societies and can capture some of the uniqueness of post-communist transition. So here you see the outline of the paper. This in fact was just published in print by Theory and Society in the first issue of 2016. So if you want to have a look at it, it's available on the internet. So I just go through the very basics, what is domination, what is legitimacy, the three types of legitimate authority. I'm sure that for most of you are trivial, and just rush very quickly through to make sure that we understand the terms the same way. Then I want to introduce what I discovered, as I said recently, Weber, fourth type of legitimate authority, and wonder why he invented this concept and why he abandoned that concept later on. And then some kind of empirical application to Weber's concepts just very briefly, whether communism was ever legitimate and different attempts to define legitimacy of communist regimes by different authors, try to apply Weber's concept of legitimacy at various types of post-communist societies. I'm very much in, will be very familiar for political scientists, but even sociologists, in the varieties of capitalism school. So I think also, I think my major work in the last couple of years was to add to the varieties of capitalism school, the varieties of post-communist capitalism, arguing that post-communist capitalism also has a great deal of varieties, and none of them fits exactly Soskice Hall typologies. So let's move on. This is very trivial, so I don't want to deal with this. Of course, Weber's distinction between power and domination is well known. I just pick a couple of crucial words to remind you the importance. So the notion Macht, or power, means that an actor has a probability that it can force its will on others, on alter, despite resistance. And this is a kind of a marginal concept for Weber. It's a concept like irrationality, right? Irrational behavior in Weber doesn't really exist. If a behavior is irrational, it is not social action. All social action belong to various kind of rationalities. Macht is also a sort of extreme case of the exercise of authority, which is unsustainable. And cannot define a society. Societies, in order to be able to reproduce themselves, have to transform themselves into Herrschaft, which is variously translated into English as authority or domination. More conservatively minded American sociologists like Talcott Parsons translated it as authority, and more left-wing Weberians translated it as domination. Weber himself actually used, especially in the early work, the term authority quite often. In the last four chapters of the economy of the first four chapters of Economy and Society, what he wrote the last just before he died, it basically vanishes and it becomes Herrschaft. So emphasizing the asymmetrical relationships between those who ruled and those who are subjected to rule. Again, just let me pick a few words to capture the importance of Herrschaft or domination. He emphasizes that there must be a voluntary compliance in this case. what is also interesting, he said, an interest in obedience. Those who subjected to authority internalize the principles. The one who exercises authority tries to legitimate it. And belief is another very important term. People have to somehow believe in the principles, but those in authority claim that they have the rights to issue commands. So it has to be voluntary. It needs an interest to obey somehow, and belief. Let me just very briefly say a word here. It, of course, not absent of coercion, far from it. The real difference between power and domination, that in the case of power, the coercion is systematic, unpredictable. In the case of Herrschaft, coercion is a promise and is not being used in a particularly systematic way. And when it is used in a systematic way, it is used in a predictable way. You know when you will be subjected to coercion. But all Herrschaft or domination always use coercion. If you happen to be in the United States, you can be even executed. So it's a serious promise that if you do something, you can be jailed. Unfortunately, nowadays you can be even tortured and executed. Now, let me just, I suppose this is all common and well known. This is something I think I read into Weber, and it may not be correct. You may want to dispute it. One of the question is, how much belief is needed in order for domination to be legitimate. Weber emphasizes here that every highly privileged group tries to develop a myth of its superiority. I think the term myth is especially important. And I was so pleased to read the commentaries in the new critical edition of Weber, where Weber scholars, unlike me, who know Weber really well, identify in Weber one of the first constructionists. All these concepts are constructions. There are no superior human beings. It is a constructed construction. But people do develop a myth. A myth which is, on the other hand, has to be accepted by the negatively privileged strata. Now, as far as the negatively privileged strata are concerned, now this is my interpretation, and I would not be able to support with Weber text. This belief in the myth of the superiority of the ruler is typically a negative belief. Those who are subordinated to authority rarely love the masters. Occasionally they do, but rarely do. But they do accept the rule and the myth of superiority because they cannot come up with a better alternative. And short of a better alternative, they say, well, we don't like it very much, but what else? The alternative would be worse. We will see this within a couple of months in the United States. We know that roughly the majority of Americans don't like either candidates. And they would love to vote for somebody else, but there will be just two candidates. And one of them will be elected because it will be seen as less bad as the other one. Generally, the masses, to put it this way, the ordinary people, only have to have this negative belief that they cannot have a more positive alternative. It's a different story with the staff. The staff does have to have a dedication the master, to the ruler, the person in authority, in order to the system to be legitimate. I actually make a distinction between a legitimation problem and a legitimation crisis. Systems usually do have legitimation problems. Legitimation problems occur when a substantial proportion of those subordinated to authority have doubts about the myth, beginning to see it increasingly just as a mythology. But since they don't see an alternative, they won't act on it, right? There are enough Eurosceptics in Europe. They don't do anything, right? They are just skeptical about Brussels bureaucracy. But after all, they just go along with it. Greece is a good example, of course. Greece is not all that chilled, what happened to them by Brussels. But on the other hand, getting out of the EU would be worse. So what can they do, right? So they have a negative belief. But the staff has to have a positive belief in the leader or the master. If it doesn't have, then we enter a time of legitimation crisis. Think of the Shah of Iran. The Iranians never liked the Shah, right? And Shah used fairly systematic coercion, but they just could not do anything against him until Khomeini came on the scene. But the dislike in Shah only created a legitimation problem for the Shah. And so he needed effective security services. He ran into a lot of trouble when the security forces decided not to support him. That's when revolutions come, right? When the staff abandons. So as I said, this is my interpretation of Weber. Now, something on again, a very brief comment that I already made. A rule is illegitimate in Weber's sense only when systematic and unpredictable coercion has to be used by somebody to rule, and it is unlikely to last for too long. In the case of communism, I will give some examples. I think of communist systems which probably Weber would accept as illegitimate. But it is a marginal case. Normally, it's not a lasting one. But Weber uses the term of non-legitimate authority. Term non-legitimate authority comes up in chapter 16 in Economy of Society in Mariana Weber's edition, which is called The City. Again, in the critical edition, I almost fell off the chair when I realized that they published the original Weber text. Weber did not use the term non-legitimate authority. So I was wondering whether non-legitimate authority was an invention by Mariana Weber, or Weber used it somewhere else. And I don't have exactly the answer to this. I think it was a very good interpretation of Mariana. In the city, Weber is writing about non-legitimate authority because it is a new type of authority which is not legitimate yet in the broader social context, but it is foreshadowing a legitimacy which actually may become and will become legitimate. Right? The essence of the chapter on the city is the city changes identity from bloodline to territoriality. People who stay long enough in the city become citizens of the city, and they become free from the feudal lord. So it is non-legitimate in a feudal system, but it is not illegitimate because it foreshadows the legitimacy of, if I may use the term, of a civil society. So I would think Weber, Mariana used the term non-legitimate authority in somewhat similar way as Gramsci used the term counter-hegemony. It is a counter-hegemonic ideology, right, which is challenging the hegemonic ideology and foreshadows a future hegemonic ideology. Well, just a minor comment. Now, this is really very trivial, and I hope I don't bore you. I really don't want to say too much. So the question Weber is asking in developing his three types of legitimate authority in economy and society, there are these three types. Obedience can be due to a personal master. This personal master may be designated by tradition, that is traditional authority, can be based on the personal charisma, that's charismatic authority, or to law and establish rule, and this is legal rational authority. Now I will do a little work on traditional authority, though it is, I think there's a lot of commonly known concept here, but it is important for me to try to clarify, I think, one distinction in Weber in my own way. Whether Weber would accept it, would have accepted it, I don't know. And again, the general description of traditional authority, I'm sure, known by everybody. Here, one has to believe in the virtue of sanctity of age-old rules, the eigenwürde of those who exercise authority. It is personal loyalty or what is so crucial. There is always a personal master, and obedience is not due to enacted rules, but to the person. The term enacted is crucial, right? The rules, as we will see in legal rational authority, will have to be enacted and permanent. You cannot pass laws retroactively, as some quasi-legal rational authorities tend to do. Now he defines a number of traditional authority, and this is again my interpretation, especially the distinction between prebendalism and patrimonialism. Traditional authority can be based in a system where those who exercise this authority is exercising it without a staff. And that's what Weber called patriarchy. It's again a historical concept, but of course it is an analytical concept. I don't have to tell feminists that patriarchal authority, unfortunately, quite widespread in societies today. the husband or the male lover exercises patriarchal authority on women and doesn't need a staff to do that. Or it exercises it with staff, and this is the way I try to interpret Weber. It has two types, prebendalism and patrimonialism. Well, I have to concede it's Weber uses these terms very differently in Economy and Society and in his other words. Patrimonialism is occasionally used as a very generic concept, basically to describe all kinds of authorities based by insertion of staff between the ruler and the ruled. But I think in the first four chapters of Economy and Society, he tries to bring some order in this concept. And let me put it this way, I try to help him to be analytically tighter. And therefore I said, well, prebendalism is a system in which the staff has only insecure property rights, while patrimonialism has secure to typically unalienable property rights. Now let me work a little on this, and this may be a bit new for those who have never worked on this concept more closely. Prebendalism usually is seen in Weber as an earlier stage of traditional authority. Patrimonialism is a more advanced or later stage. But as we will see, this is an analytical concept. It can be used in social situation in all kind of contexts. So prebendalism, and now I think I'm basically using terms of Weber, is a situation when the staff appropriates the means of administration or material property only partially. It doesn't have a full property right. For Weber, actually, the means of administration are about as important as the means of economic property. That's what makes Weber so different from Marx, right? History unfolds as the means of administrations are being appropriated from a single individual, first by the staff, individual staff members, and at the end of history by the non-apersonal state will have the monopoly of administrative means, right? So in a way, liberalism for Weber is the end of history, is the equivalent of Marx's belief to be communism, right? Communism, Marx believed, private ownership will be appropriated by the state, by some non-personal body. For Weber, it's the means of administration, which will have to appropriate it. But prebendalism, the means of administration and material means are only partially appropriated. He said the vessels receive benefices, and these benefices are granted to the vassals in exchange for services. They are not inheritable, and if they do not deliver the services, the benefit is taken away from them. So it is a service nobility who receives benefices. Patrimonialism, occasionally he calls it feudalism, on the other hand, is when the vassal is compensated by fief. And fief is something that cannot be taken away. from the staff, and it's likely to be inheritable. In universities, we have fiefdoms, right? If you are a dean or a department chair, you know very well you cannot mess around offices. Once you assign an office to a faculty member, it becomes the faculty member's fief, right? To take it away is breaking some rules of tradition, what should be at least until retirement, occasionally even after retirement, if there are enough offices, right? Emeritus professors may have claims on their office. So this is the essence of patrimonialism. They receive the fief out of the grace of the ruler, but then it becomes their personal property. Charismatic authority, I again don't want to deal with this, is probably the best known type of authority in Weber. Just to emphasize one more time Weber's social constructionism, he emphasizes that it is in the eye of the beholder, right? Very often charismatic leader really don't look all that bloody charismatic. I mean, Adolf Hitler was a ridiculous guy. And nevertheless, somehow, the charisma was attributed to Adolf Hitler by his followers. It is, therefore, a charismatic leader is considered extraordinary and treated as if it were superhuman. It doesn't mean it is an extraordinary or superhuman person, but it is people attribute to it. And why do they so? Because they want this charismatic leader in a hopeless situation to deliver miracles. And we have seen some of the building up of this charisma by Donald Trump, right? In the campaign in the last few months, as he was kind of promising miracles and for people who, especially, you know, white working class who want to reinsert their white supremacy, and he was kind of promising them, you know, to expel Latinos and build a wall and make America white again. Yeah, make America great again, probably meant. This is what the followers wanted to hear, white again. And, of course, this is again his constructionism. If he cannot deliver these miracles, he will lose his charisma. The charisma will be taken away from him. This happened to a large extent to President Obama, right, who with the slogan of hope, I am offering you a hope, was a basically, right, charismatic appeal. And I mean, he did deliver a little out of it, but not all that much. So, you know, right now he's doing all right, but for most of his presidency, he lost a lot of his charismatic leadership, and necessarily so, because he had to be operating in a legal rational authority. He had to deal with Congress and the Senate, and it's very difficult to be all that charismatic when you are dealing with Washington bureaucracy. So he also hit reality. Now, let me move then on. Well, I even don't want to talk about legal rational authority. That's obvious from what we have seen before. We have legal rational authority when the person who is a superior himself is also subject to impersonal order. So what we obey are laws and not a person. But then, this is interesting and important for the fourth type of legitimacy. Weber, interestingly, does not deal all that much where these laws and regulations are coming from. He said, norms or laws may be established by agreement, but he does not specify who should agree for a law to be valid. Or, even worse, by imposition. So it can be introduced by imposition, but it only makes it uniquely legal rational that the superior itself is subject to the same order, even if the superior imposed the rules on society, he also accepts as rules as valid for himself. It also has to be a consistent system intentionally established, and it needs to be a stability in the system. It has to be predictable. This is why legal rational authority is a sine qua non of a capitalist market economy. So that's about it. I'm sorry if I bored you too much. You may have covered this all, and I hope I will give you a new joke, and that's the fourth life of authority, what I myself discovered about a year ago and was embarrassed that I was teaching Weber the wrong way for 40 years. In October 1917, Weber was interested in a job in Vienna and gave a talk in October in Vienna, and then Austrian magazine, Neue Freie Presse, carried a long, long review of his talk. And in this talk, he said, well, once Max Weber explained the three types of authority, then he suddenly said, well, but there is actually in Western states, a new type of legitimation emerged, and this is a legitimation, I highlighted the crucial sentence, welche wenigstens offiziell ihr eigene Legitimität aus dem Willen der Beherrschten ableitet. Again, I think every word is, like often in Weber, extremely important. Here he comes to terms with the questions where the laws and rules are coming from. They are coming from, to put it very simply, from the will of the people. Well, not quite. As Mommsen said, Weber is a liberal in despair. He does not believe in the free citizens. He is talking about the Wille der Beherrschten, the will of those who are subjected to authority. Our free will is not all that bloody free, right? We are, after all live and operate under some system of domination. But nevertheless, it's a new principle, and I would say this is the principle of democracy, a democratic principle for Weber. I think legal rational authority, in my reading, doesn't mean more than to have a liberal order. Law and law. Obedience is due only to law and pre-established rules. That's legal rational authority. How the ruler got into that position is irrelevant. Well, the laws are coming from is not crucial, except in the fourth type of authority, where it is the Wille der Beherrschten. And it's also very interesting that he said, wenigstens offiziell. at least officially. And whether this is really the will of the people, or it is only a claim by the system that this is the will of the people, which put me into authority, well, as he is again a liberal in despair. as a kind of ironic formulation. I found this extremely enlightening and interesting, and I found it particularly interesting why when Weber in 2 years later in 1919 rewrites the types of authority, he forgets about the fourth type. And I just don't know. I can only speculate that he forgets about the fourth type. Here is the text. After all, he gave the talk in Vienna in October 1917, before the Russian Revolution, and before Weimar Republic. By 1919, he was greatly disenchanted in the Bolshevik Revolution, and was not particularly thrilled by the emergent mass of the Weimar Republic. So his commitment to the Wille der Beherrschten is probably not all that important anymore for the time being. But that's... Now let me just try to apply Weber to modern societies, and especially communist and post-communist societies. Just very briefly about the question of communism. Was communism ever a legitimate system? Some people, from the perspective of liberal democracy, would say, no, it never was legitimate, right? It was never legitimated by der Wille der Beherrschten, right? It was never legitimated by popular vote. Weber would be at unease to dismiss the systems as illegitimate. I think he would be at unease that the system can last for too long. He would only accept it in the cases when, as I said, coercion is systematic and somewhat unpredictable. So I think Cambodia under Pol Pot, most of the Stalin regimes, or at least many of the rule of Stalin, the Gulag, right? The fact that you, even if you were a member of the Politburo, you did not know when the KGB will come for you and they'll execute you. That made the system illegitimate, right? Massive coercive power. The Hitler regime very early on became an illegitimate system, right? Because could maintain its rule only by massive and somewhat unpredictable coercion. So I think there are, I would say the criteria is the systematic use of coercion. I think many people do refer to communist leaders as charismatic leaders. And that's an interesting case. Probably the most obvious example of a charismatic leader is Fidel Castro at certain times in history of Cuba. Right? There were occasionally even anti-regime demonstrations, and you know, Castro had the guts to come out and in front of the masses which were demonstrating against his regime to give a talk and somehow change the mood of it. He had a certain degree of charisma. probably Mao Zedong, from time to time, had some charismatic authority. Lenin may have some charisma, right? Tito had certainly a certain degree of charisma. So whenever, again, let me emphasize, this is never in the personality, right? It is always attributed to the person in times when people want change and they put their trust in the person whom they beginning to see as a semi-divine person who can deliver miracles. Communism has been often called as traditional authority. Heller Feil Marcus called it this way. Andrew Walder called Maoism as neo-traditional authority. And there is some truth to it, especially in the sense of a paternalism of certain periods of communist rules. Here I could refer to, Hungarian communism under János Kádár. János Kádár certainly, for a while, of course, he ruled in a fairly illegitimate manner between 1957 and 1963 for a few years, executing 1,000 people, gets close to excessive coercion, and whether you were executed or not, and for what, was not all that obvious. Well, I managed myself to work into jail in 1974, very briefly in Hungary. My interrogator told me that, Mr. Szelényi, if we were in 1957 for this book you wrote, it would hang you. He said, don't worry, not anymore, right? It would not happen nowadays. Right, that was a reasonably predictable system, and János Kádár and Mr. Acél were, paternalistic people. They sort of looked after our welfare reasonably, right? We could have a hot shower twice a week. So, it was quite a civilized day. So there was this paternalistic relationship. And if you had any problem, you had to write a letter to Kádár's office, and Kádár's office looked into it and tried to do something about the complaint. So it was a kind of traditionalist, paternalistic rule as such. Others even called it go-rational authority. This is Fier and Rigby wrote an interesting article. That was the closest to my understanding, that at the reform stage of communism, with scientific communism, in fact, the superiority of communism was underlined as a system which is more superior to capitalist market economy, because capitalist market economy is a messy stuff. You don't know what the outcomes will be. It's competitive, anarchistic, messy markets. While communism, if the right people, the properly trained technocrats are in the right place, it is scientifically managed, predictable, and it leads to the goals what it set up. So, legal rational authority is formal rationality, right? The formality of the law rules. Communism is a substantive rationality, is goal rationality. In fact, even in, I gather there are some people from law here. You may be familiar with Pasukanis or Lukács' early work and their emphasis that communist rule is superior because it is substantive law. It's not fussing around, with legal formalism. It depends the interest of the proletariat. Interestingly, in the 1980s, in Western legal scholarship, critical legal theory, the whole idea came back. that we should not be stuck into formalistic legalism, but it has to be substantive legalism as such. Anyway, I mean, these are the various ways how communism has been interpreted. Now, let me just go to closer to the present times very briefly. In 1989-91, not all, but in many post-communist societies, it looked like that they are moving into a legal rational order with the Wille der Beherrschten, with democratic institutions. It was a legal rational authority because it was a rule of law. The various powers, the legislative, the executive, the juridical powers were, I would say, reasonably separated. The security of private ownership was emphasized. Security of minorities has been, by and large, accepted, not necessarily to the extent as some American democratic liberals or feminists or gay activists would have liked, but to some extent it has been accepted. And there were reasonably free multi-party elections. Again, I emphasize that reasonably free. The parties were in formation, and there were some vulnerable components, even in these liberal, even in these legal rational authorities combining with a liberal democracy. I would say that probably the most biggest challenge was the privatization process. In all of these countries, the idea was to convert property relations as fast as possible. Yeltsin promised to build capitalism in 500 days. Well, it took in England 300 years, so he was trying to do it in 500 days. It was not that easy to do when there was no accumulated domestic capital, when we had very poor information about the worth and potential productivity of firms which were privatized. So there were people who were using their office powers to try to grab that public good and convert it into private property. So one big problem, even in this, even in the purest case of legal rational authority, was a weakness of the legitimacy of private ownership. It was often, people often saw it as corruption, right? As theft, started to use early the term kleptocracy, nomenclatura bourgeoisie, right? So private ownership had some suspicion. It was sort of that, certainly not a sacred institution, mostly. It was probably often driven by envy. Why that person got so rich and me not? I am not dumber than it is. That person must be dumb if he got so billions and I got nothing, right? There, separation of powers was working pretty good, but we also should not forget there were very early challenges against the separation of power, especially the fourth branch of power, the media, was very early under attack by the executive, that the media wanted to be BBC. Ruling party usually did not want it to be BBC, but wanted to use it for government propaganda. Well, in Russia, they were more successful to do that. In Central Europe, we were less successful doing that. But there were attempts, you know, even in Hungary, to try to control the media. Russia, very early on, diverted from this liberal democratic system and from legal rational authority. There were many reasons for this. One was that in Russia, unlike elsewhere, the former communist nomenclatura did play an important role in the transition, right? Yeltsin himself was a high party official. Then the KGB was building into the new system. Of course, they were building in everywhere, but much more visibly in Russia. There was also this extraordinary push to convert all the public good into private property in 500 days, and it could be done only by using patrimonial techniques. Yeltsin had to act as the good Tsar and had to somehow control the process when there was no really market way to select out who were competing for convert public ownership into private wealth, right? People did not have credit ratings. It was difficult to tell whether they will run it well. So therefore, Yeltsin used his lovely daughter, Tatiana, who told him when he probably had more vodka than he should have, who is the good guy who should get property and who is the bad guy who should not get property. So Yeltsin established himself as a good and weak Tsar who was, out of grace of the Tsar, was giving property and created a new bourgeoisie, expecting that they will support him in elections. So that's interesting that even under Putin, the Russia still insists that it is a democratic system, insists on reasonable respect of laws, and especially of what at least appears to be free elections. And therefore, Yeltsin needed the support of the new bourgeoisie. In 1996, he got it. The seven biggest bankers came together. His opponent was a communist. They did not want a communist president, so they said, well, we will support Yeltsin, and they did, and he won the elections. All the media was in the hands of the seven big bankers. Just 5 years after the breakdown of the Soviet Union, the seven people claimed they owned 50% of Russia. So that was the kind of Russian way to do it. By the end of the decade, in fact, they were establishing themselves as oligarchs. They were not only satisfied to have money, they also wanted to have power. So Klebnikov said they started to privatize the state itself. And to some extent, they did. Yeltsin was a weak Tsar with a big heart and a great deal of capacity for vodka. There is a major change with Putin, who is a strong Tsar. And he does not like these oligarchs who mess in with his business of politics. And therefore, what he did, he put all the new rich to loyalty tests. And those who passed the loyalty test could stay on. And who failed, they had the choice. They could go to Sheremetyevo Airport and fly to London, or they were locked up in Siberia for a while. This way, if I can use the Russian historical terminology, Putin managed to convert the boyars into pomeshchiks, right? That was the Russian way to conceptualize patrimonial rulers with safe property rights, the boyars, into pomeshchik, a service nobility. He managed to do this in spectacularly successfully. There is a new prebendalism emerging under Putin. He also invented a new mechanism of governance, what I call selective criminalization. If somebody is disobedient, is not serving him as faithfully as he wants it, somehow he digs into the closet of that person and finds some skeletons. Of everybody who has a couple of billion dollars, they have skeletons in their closets. The question is, in whose closets the prosecutor will find the skeleton? And then they are prosecuted, never for political reasons, always for economic reasons. Anti-corruption campaigns are a very important vehicle, right, to fight the disobedient pomeshchiks and make sure that they understand that they have what they have out of the grace of the Tsar. Now, the Putin virus is actually deeply inside of other post-communist countries. Already Yeltsin and then especially Putin began to limit the separation of powers, emphasize the strengths of the executive branch, and the leader of the executive branch is particularly powerful. And they use anti-corruption campaigns to fight enemies, never on political grounds. There are no political prisoners. People are only in jail because they cheated on taxes or they were corrupt, right? Interestingly, even China went into this direction and started to use the otherwise very popular anti-corruption campaign to fight political enemies. Anyway, so this is basically my attempt to use Weber empirically to the current post-communist systems. Thank you.